Respected Professor Bandana Saxena Ma'am, CIE Department of Education, University of Delhi. Respected Professor Anjali Bajpayee Ma'am, Department of Education, Banaras Hindu University. Respected Dr. Purabi Vaishya, Education Department, Guwahati University. Respected Dr. Dinesh Das, Coordinator, IQAC Cell. Respected all the faculty members of Gosaigaon College and their friends, participants of different colleges. Today, on the occasion of National Conference, I, Lavanya Lohakar, HUD Department of Education and convener of this National Conference, I welcome all of you. Once again, on behalf of the organizing department, I welcome all of you to this conference. The dangerous COVID-19 pandemic effect on psychosocial challenges of both kind of human resources on online education system. Although the Kothari Education Commission in 1964-66 declared that destiny of India is now safe in her classroom. That means a teaching learning process is helpful to face-to-face interaction between the two human resources, which demand active, passive, and clear on learning. The COVID-19 pandemic has created great challenges in psychosocial activities of both kinds of human resources. In this period, the human has faced some mental and social illness like anxiety, depression, aloneness, maladjustment behavior, etc. In online education system, the process, they have faced some socio-psychological problems. The first is that due to mental illness, the human beings are not properly made up their mind to online education. They are faced lots of problems like unhappiness, lack of concentration of mind, participation of online, open discussion, lack of face-to-face interaction with their classmates and friends. Secondly, the human resources has non-availability of advanced technological equipment like smartphone, computer, TV, internet, etc. From a reliable source, it was known that only 23% students have their smartphone or computer or internet connection. And more than 87 students have no any kind of modern technological equipment. The third problem is that the poor network connection in rural areas due to below electronic wear or some unfavorable circumstances, the network connection, especially in midday time, has no any sufficient network connection. And also another problem is that the online education system needs awareness of using smartphone, seriousness about the topic, good knowledge about the advanced technology, which is not widespread. And lastly, another great challenge is lack of care about individual difference. Psychologists say that no two individuals are alike. They are, although their age, ability, and mental status system, but they are have psychological barrier. So how can it possible to teach same students, same time, same period on online education? It is not possible to teaching and learning where more than 65 students of India have engaged on agricultural related productive work. So online education is not success in institutional time. But the online education system has now to be changed. Various experts have claimed that around the world, the COVID-19 will not be disappeared and it will be exist for more than 3 or 4 years. So online education will be accepted the new norms for each and every human beings. They must be familiar with the online education and knowledge about the SMS. SMS means, S means sanitize, M means masks, and S means social distance. So with the help of SMS, with the help of virtual training, with the help of ICT, the online education is to be successful. In the COVID-19 pandemic, still online education is going for more than 3 or 4 months back. It affects very positive in psychosocial challenges of teacher and student. Now online education system, both kind of human resources are psychologically make up their mind to do something for betterment of the society. Although they are maintain social distance, but they are always try to reduce the gap between the two kind of human resources for advancement of giving you knowledge and course related topic of students community. The online education system, especially in higher education, has some positive aspects also. Firstly, it develops deep knowledge with the help of collaboration of national and international resource person. Secondly, online education has great positive aspects to keep physically and mental strength, because the human beings have saved time and energy for traveling to their respective institution. Health is wealth, and sound mind makes sound body. With the help of balanced diet on time, with the help of yoga, exercise, which makes them sound body and mind. And also, another good effect is that online education has positive in terms of time of reading and publishing books, articles, journals, etc. On a reliable source, it is known that more than 600 books are published in Assam during the pandemic period. Another good aspect of online education is the pandemic period is that both kind of human resource has developed technological advancement by using smartphone, Zoom class, webinar, which are not possible before 21st century. At last but not least, I once again thank the principal, vice principal of Gosaigaon College, the LearnNet resource person, participant, coordinator of IQAC cell, and computer operator to giving the Department of Education to this opportunity for organizing the conference. Thanks for presently listening. Thank you.
Thank you, madam.
Next, according to our schedule program, now I would like to invite Dr. Dinesh Das, coordinator of IQAC cell and HOD of Department of Economics, to deliver welcome address.
Namaskar and good afternoon to you all. Honorable principal of this college, respected vice principal, come inaugurator of the conference, S.J. Sordar sir, invited learned speakers from University of Delhi, Professor Vandana Madam, Professor Anjali Madam from Banaras Hindu University, Dr. Purobi Madam from Guwahati University, dear participants, those who are attending this platform from different parts of the country, today I really feel proud to have this opportunity to welcome you all to this platform on the occasion of the online national conference on COVID-19 pandemic, its impact on psychosocial challenges on online education for teachers and students, organized by Department of Education, Gosaigaon College, in collaboration with IQAC, Gosaigaon College, Gosaigaon. It is all about concern that the outbreak of COVID-19 is an endemic which has affected on one and all aspects of our lives without discriminating between the rich and the poor, or in case of nations, whether a developed and underdeveloped one. The COVID-19 virus is a new virus linked to the same family of viruses as severe acute respiratory syndrome and sometimes of common cold. Coronavirus has been believed to be originated in the wildlife market in Wuhan, Hubei province, China in late December 2019. The COVID-19 pandemic is far more than a health crisis. The pandemic has already exposed the health vulnerabilities facing India, especially its rural poor and urban slums. As a measure to continue the community transmission of the virus, the government of India announced a nationwide lockdown, which was extended twice to continue through 31st May 2020. Due to nationwide lockdown by COVID-19, it has brought about unprecedented changes in education systems in India. Schools, colleges, and universities have been shut across India since March 2020 due to the outbreak of the novel coronavirus. All educational institutions' closure impact not only students, teachers, and parents, but have far-reaching economic and social consequences. Schools, colleges, and universities are the hubs of social activity and human interaction. When educational institutions are closed, many students miss out on social contact that is essential to learning and development. This is a crucial time for the education sector. Board examinations, nursery school admissions, entrance tests of various universities, and competitive examinations, among others, are all held during this period. As the days pass by with no immediate solution to stop the outbreak of COVID-19, school, college, and university closures will not only have a short-term impact on the continuity of learning for more than 285 million young learners in India, but also engender far-reaching economic and social consequences. The crisis, the structure of schooling and learning, including teaching and assessment and methodologies, was the first to be affected by these closures. Only a handful of private schools could adopt online teaching methods. Their low-income private and government school counterparts, on the other hand, have completely shut down for not having access to e-learning solutions. The students, in addition to the missed opportunities for learning, no longer have access to healthy meals during this time and are subject to economic and social stress. The crisis also significantly distributed the higher education sector as well, which is critical determinant of a country's economic growth and development. A large number of Indian students, second only to China, enrolled in universities abroad, especially in countries most affected by the pandemic, the USA, UK, Australia, and China. Many such students have now been closed from leaving these countries. If the situation persists, in the long run, a decline in the demand for international higher education is expected. In this backdrop, with collaboration of internal quality assurance, Gosayok College, the Department of Education, Gosayok College proposes to hold a one-day online national conference on COVID-19 pandemic, its impact on psychosocial challenges on online education for teachers and students. Today, the 4th September 2020, to address various challenges of this issue due to COVID-19 pandemic. Today is very significant on which scholars and participants from different parts of the country gather here on a common platform to analyze the various challenges of this issue. I hope that the discussion and deliberation during conference will come out with concrete action plans and remedial measures to some extent to resolve the challenges of this issue and will also contribute to the society towards further development. At last, once again, I convey my warm welcome to you all for presenting this virtual platform and make the occasion a grand success. Thank you one and all. Dhanyabad.
Thank you, Dr. Dinesh Das, coordinator IQSSL, for delivering a valuable speech. Next, as per CDL program, I would like to invite Mrs. Nancy Pathak, Associate Professor of Department of Education, to introduce about the invited speaker. Nancy Pathak, please.
Namaskar, good afternoon everyone present today's national webinar. I, Mrs. Meenakshi Pathak, is honored and it's a great pleasure for me to introduce one of our eminent speaker who is going to bring into light on the topic online education, the evolving social dynamics. Our speaker, Dr. Vandana Saxena, has a very luminous academic as well as professional career. She is currently working as a professor of CIE, Department of Education, University of Delhi. She completed her MSc in Physics from University of Delhi in 1991. She also passed M.Ed from University of Delhi in 1993. She was awarded the degree of PhD in Education from University of Delhi in 2001. She has presented more than 36 of research papers in different international and national conferences in different fields. Her 8 referred research papers have been published in various reputed national and international journals in India and abroad. She has published 7 chapters in edited books. She has authored as well as edited 3 books now. In her academic persuasions to cultivate democratic educational environment, she is engaged with teaching, training, research, and consultations focusing upon developing research-based thought, provoking pedagogical designs addressing issues of diversity and inclusion across all ages. She has worked on multiple projects and assignments with MHRD, World Bank, USIEF, UGC, NCERT, NCTE, and RCI. She has addressed and written in many national and international forums. Currently, her prime contemplation is on conceptualizing research in education, driving research questions, academic writing and ethics in research, for which she is conducting workshops with researchers in various universities and pan-India level. She has been diligently promoting the case of equal opportunities for all, symbolized by the conscious use of lower casting for the writing herself. Her research interests are diversely pedagogy and inclusion, sincere education, and research in education. So now I would like to invite Professor Vandana Saxena to share a few words with us. Thank you.
Sabko namaste, dopahar ki namaste. So we call it a good afternoon to everyone. It's my pleasure to be here with all of you. I see 210 participants, so I must say a big round of applause to the organizers of this forum, you know, wherein they have been able to invite people on this platform. It's also very interesting to see, I was reading through the chat simultaneously, that people have come in from different places. So I want an extra, you know, round of applause. Although we can't do it, but we can make some kind of noise like this for all the organizers that sitting in Northeast, they have been able to reach places like Madhya Pradesh and even, you know, other places across India. So very well done, the organization team. My congratulations once again to you. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. While I speak, I try to go on to sharing the screen as well. Just one moment. Yeah. So I have been, just a moment. That's great.
Yeah, it's
so,
okay.
It's okay, na? Yeah. So we are sitting, you know, we usually celebrate the days, but we are getting into a habit of celebrating the eves also. So today on 4th of September, we are sitting on the eve of Teacher's Day, which happens to be tomorrow. So I would like to start with thanking my teachers and my scholars and my students who have helped me grow as a teacher, you know, where I am today. The entire credit goes to my teachers and my students with whom I have interacted. So a very big namaskar to all my students and all my teachers as well. I was given the mandate to speak about online education. It might seem that we have been in online education for so long, so why we are so much troubled about it right now? You know, we started with it somewhere in March, mid. So by now we should have got used to of it. But frankly saying, I don't think we have got used to of it as of now, you know, because when it all started in March, it appeared that we just have to manage it for 2 more months and then it will finish because, you know, the session will end. And then when the new session comes, we'll start afresh and we'll go back to the mode where we were originally at. So everyone hoped that we would be going back to the same thing and we would be going back to the same scenario. Now, not having conquered COVID the way we would have thought of it to be, we are still struggling with it. So the schools and the colleges, all the educational institutions are still closed in the sense that we do not have those kind of physical contact and geographical regional proximities that we have all enjoyed in our, that we have all grown up with, you know. So if someone asks me school, school means a lot of students around me, a lot of my friends snatching each other's tiffin box and running after each other. You know, that's the scenario we have for school in our mind, a very active, very bubbling place. But then we come over to this place and we are like, no, you sit in your own room, you have a screen in front of you and you just have to talk to each other. I think very difficult. We have since beginning learned that humans are social animals. So when our social path is attacked, when our social path is being looked through, we get a little disturbed, you know, because we are not very used to of living in non-social or asocial environments. So I think that's the challenge. Another challenge was, another way which I see it to be is that, you know, the teachers, the school and the family were different places for us. So the parents will meet the teachers only on the days of PTM. And we all know that what PTM meant for us, you know, for parents also it is scary, for students also and for teachers also. All the three segments fear a lot about PTMs, you know. So now the parents are sitting right over there, whether they're working online or they're not working online. So when Dr. Das approached me and he said that we need to have some kind of discussion on it, I thought, let's talk about the evolving social dynamics, that how our social scenarios have changed, how those people who were not a part of classroom have now become our classroom partners, and how those people who were a part of classroom are sitting at distance from us, you know. So that was the idea of coming at with this kind of a title, that what are the social dynamics which are evolving and how the change of everyone who is a partner, who is a stakeholder in this entire scenario is changing, how it is all, how every one of us will have to take care of it. So I just thought I'll build a bit of perspective onto it and then come over to the things. See, when we're talking about students across all levels, whether we're talking about a elementary student, a secondary student, or a tertiary would mean a higher education student, whichever level of education we are talking about, there are always three kind of perspectives in which through which the student is surrounded by. One is the student's own socio-cultural environment. Other one is the educational practices or theories through which we try to approach the educational premise in the classroom with those people. And third is a state. A state means the policy, the structure of the institution, and all those kind of legit part of it, the legit part of education system when we are talking about it. I read today in the newspaper that Supreme Court has now said that if colleges want, they can conduct exam for first and second year also. Whereas earlier it was like, okay, you may not conduct. So if certain universities get very overwhelmed, then they might just go back and say that we want to conduct exam for first year and second year also. So that is what I meant by state, you know, same kind of confusion which we have had earlier, whether all the final year students across India should have exams or not. So now finally Supreme Court says no, UGC can only take the decision and you have to have exam for final year students. What I'm trying to say is that students are in a very complex situation by themselves because they are surrounded by various facets. So when I say student, the student doesn't come as a singular identity. Student comes with all these kind of baggages overloaded within them. And when I as a teacher or when I as a parent or when I as a person go on and try to interact and talk about student, it becomes very critical for me to understand that a student is coming. I have to see the student from all these perspectives which are coming attached to that particular student. So student is not a single entity. And that is why the different kind of combination and permutation which this one will have, I think it's very, 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 very interesting and complex for us as teachers or teacher educators to understand. See, I remember people like every other university, our website has all the numbers of all the faculty members and things like that. I think each university has that kind of provision now. I have received numerous calls from unknown students. This, I work with Department of Education. I don't deal with undergrad colleges. We have something around 63 undergrad colleges and something around 2 lakh final year students in our Delhi University. But I have received an empty number of calls from people who would just abruptly pick up a call and say, Professor, I want to talk to you. And then I'm like, what happened? Will the exams happen or they won't happen, you know? So that kind of anxiety with which the student is there, and then you can't just tell them that I don't know. But then, you know, this person is calling you from your own institution, maybe not, but your own fraternity, and you have that emotional responsibility, the social responsibility to console this particular child. And it always happened that the kind of anxiety with which they called us, when we spoke for around 5 minutes or something like that, they were more settled and they worked properly like that. Many a number of times I had to tell them that my own daughter is in final year Delhi University. I also don't know whether she'll have exams or not. So please, we are all in the same boat and we all have to have certain kind of patience. So, I mean, the kind of discussion that the anxiety that built up among students because of multiple state perspectives is something which is very, very, which has put them in a very critical situation. This is something which I'm talking about the senior students, the college final year students, but a lot of students from school also had the similar kind of anxiety. I had friends whose kids were appearing in final year 12th class exam or 10th class board. All the anxiety being informed the people, we were so anxious. And so we were thinking that what will happen to the people who are not aware of it, the common people, the parents of the students who are not aware of it. And Delhi CBSE has so many students dropping in and working on it. So I think the level of anxiety is something which has been very high among all people. I'm not trying to say that the teachers have been less anxious. I remember all of us have been also very, very anxious. Suddenly the school teachers have to go on and they have to plan everything online. Terrible. In Delhi, people were trying online things, but they were not trying online things in the sense that, the entire classroom will become online. So it has been a lot of challenge. I've taken lot many sessions with school teachers also, especially in science, because that happens to be my area, physics, wherein they wanted to know that what else can we do apart from going for this and how do we replace this entire idea of laboratory experience and things like that. So this entire the entire scenario of understanding students has been a very, very complicated one. And we all are working towards it. I can't say that we have achieved or anybody has answers to it, but it's very important as I've always said that, it's very important that we are able to formulate exact and precise questions so that we work towards them and we try to find answers to it. So a student, as I said, is a very complex entity, and we need to understand this student from a very critical perspective as such. See, this student, when we talk about the, as I said, that there are three parts of it. When I talk about the sociocultural part of this student has multiple partners, you know, who are coming into it. So there is community, there is, and for the student, the immediate person now is the family. They are not used to seeing their parents in their classroom, but now family and the parents are part of their classroom, which is not, students are not taking it very, very happily, you know, they're not very happy about it, because, you know, they always felt that the school is their space, that kind of belongingness to that segment, that what, where, this is very unique to me. So my classroom, my teachers, my friends, my peers are very, very unique to me. They've always had that notion. And now this notion is being challenged because how they talk to their friends, how the teacher is conversing, a parent is sitting or a grandparent is sitting, and they've become part of that interaction. So that kind of privacy which the student has had with that kind of relationship is also hit somewhere. You know, there is an issue with that also. And with that kind of hitting, again, it has caused a kind of a different kind of anxiety in students, that they do not have relationships with their family and the peers the same way they used to have. That's something which is very typical to them. When it comes to peers, we all have had great stories of being in our classrooms, and we have always felt that this is the segment. So these are the five people I take lunch with. This is the team, this is my volleyball team, this is my football team, this is this, this is that. So I've always, you know, all of us always have that kind of an experience, and obviously children also have that kind of an experience. So they're missing on to all those social interactions at this point of time. So it's very critical that we understand. I was talking to one of the students and I said, okay, so during this class, this boy is in class 9th, and I just spoke with him and I said, what is that thing you miss the most during online classes? And this person ended up saying that I miss my recess period a lot. So that's something where, you know, your peers, your lunchtime is something where, which is, I think, which every student look forward to. And the tragedy is it is the shortest in the timetable. So this is the other way, that the entire timetable is filled with other things. So these kind of things, the peer interaction also is something which is very critically hampered during this particular point of time, and one needs to look at it. When I say community as a mixture of school community as well as the neighborhood community, the neighborhood of the where the child stays, you know. This is again something which is very terribly hit in this particular point of time, and people need to understand that how many, what kind of social catharsis would happen when the people are in the community. So when you talk to different people, when you talk to students who are older to you, when you mentor students who are younger to you in a usual school, it becomes very easy for you to have a presence of yourself. So that community interaction, which would lead to catharsis, that community interaction, which would lead to an idea of I can also mentor somebody, all those interactive ideas have gone away. The relationships, the relatives are not meeting each other, although I've seen many people holding online meetings and stuff like that, online birthday parties and stuff like that. But it's different, you know, you have to get accustomed to the whole idea. I remember the final year student in all the colleges have been very, very disturbed that they had planned all these 3 years for their farewell and they have not had a farewell. Which everybody looks forward to. Same with classes, 12 students also. So I think all these things which are emerging are taking the student to a different pedestal altogether. The student by themselves have multiple experiences, you know, they have lived experiences of happiness with peers. I've just tried to give certain examples, these are not the only example. The self-concept of the student has been very terribly hit because of the accomplishments and abuses, you know, we can't say that for every student, school is a very pleasant place. There are certain students who go through some kind of bullying and abuse also. So that's very important for us to understand that, you know, these things has also, for certain students, not going to school may have been a blessing, you know, because they are saved from that abuse. But we also need to understand that this abuse should not happen within house, you know. So within the house, what kind of family interactions the kids have is also, that also needs to be looked up to. But at the same time, accomplishments, you know, when you do something, when you do good on a test, when you do good in an experiment, there are always aha moments when you are in the school, you know. Certain things that make you happy, when you suddenly solve a question, everybody is very happy. So all those kind of smaller ideas of accomplishment have also demolished, you know, those opportunities are also breathed out. And that is why, you know, this is again a critical situation from the point of view of the psychosocial health of the students. Community experiences have also changed. Now they're in the family, you know, so there is nothing like that. They are represented better or less better from each other or something like that. So community experiences have also changed a lot, and that is why the students are again stuck into that whole thing. This entire idea of online education has given us or has taken us to a very different platform with regard to family support. You know, what kind of earlier, you know, the family had to support for things like projects, which are after school things. Now the family has to support the online going classes also. So my school teacher friends, they would tell me that when they take a test, you know, so students are asking in between, the parents are telling them the answers. So even when they're monitoring online, this kind of help is also going on by the parents themselves. So the role of the parents has very dramatically changed. There are pleasant experiences also. I've had one of my colleagues who says that I'm not very good in mathematics, but then he used to sit with his son, who is in class 6. He used to sit with him for the mathematics class, and he calls them and tells me, "Madam, this mathematics teacher is so good. Now I've started learning mathematics." So I think the parents don't know, the teachers and the school don't know that they are taking fees only for the child, but the parents are also learning simultaneously. They better charge fees from them also. So all this kind of family structures and the interaction and the participation of the family in the entire idea has also changed and has also gone a lot of change. The inter-age relationships is something which I am a big fan of. When we go to the school, if it's a composite school, the youngest child will be of age 6, and the oldest person would be could be anybody in 60 or 60 plus. So this entire school offers a kind of a community structure, you know, where inter-age relationships are made. The child learns how to talk to their juniors, how to talk to their classmates, how to talk to their seniors who are students, but also how to talk to different people in the school, how that interaction, you know, the teacher interaction with teacher, the administrator, the school guard, the school support staff, the conductors, the drivers of the buses and things like that. So it's a lot of learning experience for the child when the child goes to school and he or she is left to himself or herself to figure out that how do I need to learn and interact. That entire experience is missing for all of our students in that regard. So That very important idea of community relationship that we used to cultivate through school education in conventional mode is also missing, and that's a great loss for us to come. This entire relation, I just thought that we should talk a little bit about this entire relationship. I've said a lot of things about it earlier also, but this teacher, the student being surrounded by educational institute means whatever be the legit or the formal things which are offered by the educational institution, their organization, their planning, as well as the family and the parents with whom the child is there. And the third segment is the teachers. All these three people have to interact with students. I think the earlier practices were very set, you know, the teacher will look after the content, and the class teacher will look up the managerial part of the behavior, managerial part of the student, and the family will come in as a support system to support the education of the child, whether they do it by themselves or they arrange for certain kind of support for the child. But there's a discussion in all ideal conditions, there's a discussion between the teacher and the family, and then they come up with certain kind of solution. Okay, the child has to be helped in this particular manner, which is also missing in the current scenario. And we need to really look at resolve this whole thing in certain manner. One of the problems that I faced is that even MHRD has started saying that you can only hold online classes for 2 hours. Now, what does that mean? Does that mean that I should not hold school for more than 2 hours? Or does that mean that I can hold the scholastic classes for 2 hours? So when we're talking about holding classes for 2 hours, it's only the scholastic classes which the people are talking about. And school is much more than scholastic classes. That is something we all need to understand and we need to delve upon. When we were winding up the session last time from March to say something like April or something like that, when we were winding up the sessions, we were very clear that, the winding up will happen and we will move into the classrooms the same way as we were there earlier. But now that the scenario has changed, the schools will have to make certain exceptions about talking about themselves, you know, that how would they want the other kind of things in the timetable to be exposed to the students, whether it is the counselor or the special educator or even the sports. I know of certain schools who have started online sports activity. So the sports teacher will come and they'll ask them to do something online, make certain kind of groups and all that. You know, something like a library period, if we have to think about creative ways of organizing all these things and not leaving the thing only to that extent. Now, this is something which I proposed in my research, in one of my researches. So I did that in 2001, you know, but this is exactly the challenge that we have at this point of time currently. What should be the nature of the classroom interaction? How do I plan my classroom interaction? So in multiple places, people have said that when I was discussing with teachers, they said that, you know, students sometimes don't want to come up. They don't put their videos on and there is an issue of bandwidth. So we can't have planning for all those kind of things. So how do we go ahead with that? So plan, teachers will have to think a little differently. And that is why our sessions for teachers will have to be different when we are talking about how do they plan the nature of the classroom. How can they involve the students in the classroom now that, you know, they are not physically into the same space. Then the planning that initiates the learning process is what I said. Facilitate active participation of the learner. Develop an understanding of and grounding in passion for the subject. You know, for many of the students who are moving from 5th to 6th grade, you know, that this is a very significant challenge for the teachers, you know, because the syllabus till grade 5 is little simpler. And as they move to grade 6, it gets divided into discipline-oriented. We get discipline-oriented syllabus. So this is a lot of challenge for at all the three places, you know, place 1, grade 6, place 2, grade 9, and place 3, grade 11. The teachers are faced with all these three entry levels are there, and teachers are faced with multiple challenges at this point of time. So now that you are not in touch with them, you don't have any bulletin boards in hand. Earlier, you know, we would advise a lot that you put a very vibrant bulletin board in the classroom and you do this, you engage them into club activities and things like that. Now that all that is not happening, it remains to be understood that how can we do this thing? And this is a very specific challenge for all the subjects. I would not say that science and maths are more challenging. I would say language is equally challenging when we are talking about creating a passion for that subject amongst all the students. Gaining a sense of responsibility in the overall scheme of life. You know, children are thinking that, this is something, you know, this particular point is something where I guess we can really do a great part, you know. Being alone, being left to themselves, the students are able to understand that their life belongs to them. And it is something where they have to be motivated enough and responsible enough to take care of their lives. And that is something which I see as the only plus point of this entire online classroom scenario. But that also requires a very supportive surrounding. So if you have a supportive parent group, if you have supporting peer, if you have supporting teachers who help you, who give you that kind of a self-concept, it is wonderfully done. But if in case a child is not attended to properly, if a child is there with special needs, if there are children with special psychological needs, if there are children who have been into who have been interacting with counselors and other things like that. Then the situation is all the more demoralizing for these students. So we need to be very critically talking. When we talk about the group of students, it's very important for us to understand that different group of students will respond differently to a given scenario. And that is precisely what will happen here also. Creating a harmoniously, this I think is the overall, you know, focus. This should be the overall focus of any education system at any level. Creating a harmoniously developed person is spreading the rays of excellence all around. Ultimately, whatever be the purpose of education, the person is going into the field, and this person, when this person becomes a social entity, you know, when they become a part of a social organization, it's very important that these people come up with certain kind of positive attitudes. I felt that in 2001, and I continue feeling that it is absolutely non-negotiable. The kind of personality, and this is exactly what is the theme of your presentation, of your seminar also, that is the harmonious development of a child or a student hurt when we are talking about the online class. It's a very critical question, and if it is hurt, if we say that we don't have the older means of looking after them, then what do we need to do further is something which is very important for us to know. This probably would be my last slide, and I hope I'm keeping up with the time of 30 minutes that was given to me by Mr. Das. So educational system, as I have been saying, they'll have to revision their planning and organization, and they have to add multiple post-scholastic activities now. You know, it is not possible that you only have the scholastic subjects on your thing. You will have to have. How you will hold a party, party money, any function, if the schools were organizing any kind of festivals, how will they hold those festivals online now? We'll have to think out of the box and we'll have to work on that. Recess is typically for the school students, but as I'm told that there are the participants in our seminar are also from different colleges, undergrad colleges and all that. So I thought canteen time is also very, very important. And I'm sure that all of us remember our college times, not only through lectures, but what we did in canteens also. So it's a very, very typical challenge that how do we create that canteen time in the with the people. So a pertinent thought needs to be given to counselor and special education services for supporting students across all level. The educational and planning concept of the schools or the educational institutions should have a special focus on this. Till date, they were not focusing much on the counseling services and the special education services, but it's important that since we are here, this lockdown is here to stay for educational institutions, it's important that we move back to organizing the counseling and the special education center. I remember we used to have, I know some of the schools will have those sessions, life skill sessions and things like that, which the counselors will take. One has to get back to those kind of things and provide those nuances to students once again. So that a school looks like what it used to be, the timetable has to look like what it used to be, and not only doing science, maths, language, social studies. No, you have to get back to drawing classes. One has to get back to music classes. All those classes will have to come back, you know, it's very important for us to do that. Also, it requires educators not only to learn new attitudes, new pedagogies and new content, but also how to integrate these in everyday working with the students. You know, you're working every day with the students. How will you integrate this is something which we will all, and you know, somebody might say that there are a lot of people attending this seminar will say that that I came and I spoke about all these ideas and then I gave no solutions to it. But I think the solutions will have to be very indigenous. What kind of technology your students have? Everybody doesn't have the same kind of technology available to them. And that's one of the biggest question marks when we're talking about online classes, which is mentioned by the coordinators and the other speakers also earlier. So I think uske hisab se, according to that, one will have to come up with and one will have to do something, think of it, that what kind of solutions can I come up with? So there can't be uniform and singular solutions in all contexts. The solutions will have to be context specific and one needs to work on them. This is something which I think is would be the last comment that I want to make, that it is expected that by becoming socially responsive and culturally responsive, sensitive as a collective, all the particles in education will be able to reinvent their role in the existing as also in the coming times. You know, it's very important. I can't say that I have been a teacher for 30 years, I will continue to be like that. No, I need to change. I need to evolve to the new scenario. You know, this is something the parent will also have to evolve. The parent can't say that I have, you know, challenges that in Delhi, and I'm sure that other places also, our parents are also working from home. So earlier it used to be a blessing that my mother is a teacher and you know, I go to the school and she can help me because she knows the school system. But now it's a curse because the mother is also busy from 7 o'clock till 2 o'clock online. And she can't just look after the child from that reason. So I think this whole engagement has become very troublesome for all of us. But we need to understand that it holds a lot of promise also within itself. You know, it can. We have always been talking about individual learning. We have always been talking about that how do we create independent learners. You know, this is the moment where which we need to make use of. That how do we make students, how do we mobilize them to search on their own? How do we mobilize them to bring in more resources to the classroom? So that kind of autonomous learner, that kind of creativity in the classroom that we always wanted. This is the occasion that we have been cribbing about. So this is the time when we can come up and we can say that, oh yeah, but you know, we can do something and this is something which can work because now the student is not in that chaos. We have always been saying that education is not related to daily experiences of the child. We can relate it to the daily experience now, the kind of activities that we give to the students, especially in science, the kind of activity. I can talk more about science and that too physics because that is where I've been talking to people a lot about. So it's very, 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 you know, it's very, this is an opportunity to tell them that your entire chemistry lies in the bathroom and the kitchen, you know, so pick up this and do this experiment with salt or do this experiment with haldi, turmeric and all those kind of things. I think this is the time where we always wanted that kind of a bridge to be done. And this is the time where that bridge between the students' learning can be situated and located in the students' own experiential lives. And that is something which is very, very important for us. I would like to thank you once again and would like to quit. Thank you for listening. I just hope that I did some justice to the seminar. I just kept that hope with which I was invited to this seminar. Thank you very much. And yeah.
Thank you, Professor Dr. Vandana Saxena, for your reliable speech about the social dynamics, about the role of parents, about the integration of all co-curricular and curricular activities. Once again, I thank you, ma'am, to give a reliable lecture. Next, as for agenda, I request Professor Abdul Hussein Ansari, to Assistant Professor of Department of Education, to introduce about the invited speaker. Abul Hussein Ansari, please. Hello, Ansari.
Yes, madam.
Yes.
Respected Principal Gusaigaon College, respected Vice Principal Gusaigaon College, respected convener, Madam Lavanya Lawkar, respected coordinator, Madam Minaki Pathak, respected coordinator, IQAC CL, Gusaigaon College, respected participant, participated on online national conference, and dear technician, I am going to say a brief biodata of Dr. Purabi Bosso. Dr. Purabi Bosso, assistant professor in the Department of Education, Guwahati University, Guwahati, did her master degree in education from Cotton College under Guwahati University in 1998 and BA in 1999. She has been awarded PhD degree in 2011 and has been in this teaching position since 2005. Earlier, she obtained top in Assam Education Service under Assam Public Service Commission and joined in the prestigious Cotton College as lecturer in the Department of Education in 2003 and resigned to join Guwahati University in 2005. Dr. Bosho contributed several book chapters in various edited books, has a number of research publications in various national and international journals, and presented papers in different national and international seminars and conferences. Dr. Bosho is actively associated with different academic organizations, NGOs, and teacher education bodies of national and international levels, and is also a life member of those bodies. He is also a recognized visiting team member of NCTE and an empaneled resource person of Center for Cultural Resources and Training, New Delhi, since 2010 and 2011, respectively. Presently, five research scholars are pursuing PhD under her guidance, and one has been awarded PhD recently. Her areas of research interest include special education, educational psychology, teacher education, mental health and stress management, educational organization and administration, etc. Dr. Bosho believes that positive and non-judgmental attitude and practice of healthy and purposeful living bring changes in anyone's life, and these qualities help in creating a better and peaceful world for everyone. So I would like to request Dr. Kurubi Bosho to deliver a lecture on COVID-19 pandemic, its impact on psychosocial challenges on online education for teachers and students. Thank you.
So very good afternoon to everyone. Thank you for your nice introduction. So respected convener, organizing committee of this national webinar, Mrs. Labanya Lokobaido, coordinator of the webinar, Mrs. Meenakshi Pathak Baido, respected Dr. Dinesh Das, coordinator IQAC Gosagar College, respected invited speaker, Professor Vandana Saxena, ma'am, from University of Delhi, and Professor Anjali Baspai, ma'am, from BHU, and esteemed participants. Actually, I'm indeed privileged and honored to have been invited as a speaker of this national webinar, organized on a very pertinent topic. And that day when Dr. Das approached me regarding the topic and all, so in one word, I gave the consent. I'm so much thankful to Dr. Das for giving me this opportunity to speak my or to offer my views in front of you. And I'm really thankful to the Department of Education, Gosagar College. And one name needs a special mention once again. He is none other than Dr. Dinesh Das, because he was in constant communication with me just after the previous international conference held in next previous month. So once again, I'm very much thankful to you, Dr. Das, for giving me this platform. And regarding the situation, as you know, the whole world is going through a very, very tough time at present due to this sudden outbreak of COVID-19. And the situation in Assam is much more critical in the last few days. We are living in uncertainty, and almost every day getting the news of deaths of our near and dear ones. But still, life must go on. We are trying to keep ourselves busy to lead a normal life. We are attending conferences, seminars. We are holding classes, online classes. We are holding different kinds of other kind of like seminar kind of things. Then we are also chatting with friends and family members. We're using the social media, but we are still in a very kind of stressful situation. We are constantly, you know, we are having a fear. We are carrying mental stress every time. We are having a constant rate of infection all the time. And this kind of stress sometimes have emotional and physical manifestation also. So when Dr. Das approached me regarding the topic and all, I asked him about what topic Vandana ma'am and Anjali ma'am going to talk about. So when I got to know about their topic, that they will be mainly confining to the online education, so I hurriedly switch on to the main theme, that is the psychosocial well-being of our students and teaching community. So I will try to focus on purely on psychological basis and try to give some of the tips, share some of the tips how to maintain a psychosocial well-being. So let me share my screen. Can you see? Is it visible?
Yeah, ma'am. But you have to press the F5.
Okay. I'm going from the beginning. Yes. Now is it visible?
Yeah, it's okay.
Yes, is it visible?
Yeah, it is
visible. Okay, so the topic I have chosen is maintaining psychosocial well-being during this COVID-19. Pandemic. So, as you know, we have witnessed unprecedented circumstances in 2020, and this pandemic has totally shaken the pride of the human civilization. And we are also not sure that up to what limit this situation will prevail. I'm not sure about the definite time period, but it may be a longer period of time we have to deal with such kind of situation. And not only the teaching community, but every section of the society has been suffered and affected by this COVID pandemic. New words have been incorporated in the dictionary, like quarantine, isolation, mass hysteria, anxiety, stress, depression. These are the common words now. And anxiety and depression am I audible? So technological glitch. I was disconnected, I think.
Ma'am, you are audible, ma'am.
Okay. So I think some problems in my slides. So there are so many social strata, those who are affected by this COVID-19 pandemic. So the patients and the quarantine people are the most traumatic one. They are feeling so much kind of socio-cultural issues, and interventions are also done accordingly. Then healthcare providers, they are also been exposed maximum, and due to which the psychosocial issues are maximum on these personnel. So healthcare providers, they are constantly having the fear of infection, and intervention from the government side is very, very encouraging. Then most importantly, the children, adolescents, as well as the old age group. These are the most vulnerable ones. So far as the report has been released, not only the oldest people, but children and adolescents in our state are also been victimized due to this particular COVID-19 pandemic. And these are the psychosocial issues, and interventions have been also done accordingly. I won't go details about this. Then the domestic caregivers, marginalized groups, they are also having lots of psychosocial issues, and interventions have been done accordingly. So main psychosocial issues are like the stress, depression, economic crisis, then violation, fear of violation of lockdown rules, then anxiety, then stigma, discrimination. Then sometimes they are also doing certain kind of crimes. Like in some areas, I have heard that the people are spitting, the infected people are spitting to the other people so that infection can be spreaded. So interventions regarding COVID-19 pandemic is very, very encouraging from the government part. But still, we have to take care of ourselves. We have to take care of ourselves by certain kind of information and applying some of the intervention from our own side. So I'm going to talk about the wellness, overall wellness. So wellness, what is wellness? It is the feeling of the comfort, healthy and happy. That is, that state can be termed as the wellness. So wellness cannot be obtained through only from physical side. So it is a holistic approach, and it is a combination of different kinds of dimensions. So here, Dr. Bill Hackel, he mentioned about the six dimension of wellness, like occupational, physical, social, intellectual, and spiritual and emotional. So occupational wellness can be obtained by following certain principles, like you have to choose a career which is consistent with your personal values, interests and beliefs. Then physical well-being can be obtained by regular exercises, the intake of dietary like the balanced diet and some healthy practices. Then social wellness, we are to some extent very selfish, but if we give up our selfishness, if we have a mind to contribute or giving back to the society, then we can definitely get back our wellness. Social wellness can be obtained by like this kind of activities. Then intellectual and mental wellness, we can practice some kind of creative work. By doing so, we can definitely have this intellectual and mental wellness. Then spiritual and emotional wellness are also in the part of the holistic approach. So spiritual, which is binding all wellness all together. So what is spiritualism? It is the searching for your purpose in life. So how can we search for the purpose in life? By following the principle like live each day in a way that is consistent with you, with your values and beliefs. Then emotional, be aware of and accept your feeling and don't deny them. So by applying all this holistic approach, to some extent we can be fit and fine. So regarding the main topic, the psychosocial well-being. So what is psychosocial well-being? It is the combination of the two words, the psychology and the social. So psychosocial well-being is also a part of this holistic approach, and it refers to the state of mental and social wellness, and which influence overall emotional and social behavior of the individual. Excuse me. So, but wellness is not a constant process. Every one of us is having some sort of problems in our day-to-day life, and it will be continued. Even from yesterday, I'm suffering from low BP. My BP today is only 104 and 67. So every day we will not equally enjoy wellness. We will have different kind of problems, but still minimum things we have to take care of for the better living. So when we talk about the psychosocial development, psychosocial well-being, one name come to our mind, that is, who is Erikson, Erikson. Erikson's psychosocial development theory is the most acceptable one. And if, as academia, if we try to understand the different concepts under this Erikson theory, to some extent, we can guide our students, guide our children as teachers and parents very effectively. We can develop a very, very healthy lifestyle and contribute to their personal growth as well. And he modified Freud's controversial theory of psychosexual development, and he actually divided our whole life into 8 different stages. And these 8 different stages, according to Erikson, in every stage, we meet certain kind of crisis or conflict, and these stand as barrier to our personal development. And if we do not understand those crises and conflict, and automatically after aging, we will step into the next level, but we will also carry those crises and conflict along with us, and it will definitely make some overburden, it will overburden us with the new crisis as well. So it's very important to know and to understand the crisis in each stage, and if these are satisfactorily met at the different stages, then we can develop certain kind of psychosocial qualities, which will be the base for our personal growth and development. And failing to which, this will definitely create havoc in our whole life. So these are the stages according to Erikson, and on the basis of the its stages, the corresponding age limit is also given, and the psychological crisis. For example, the stage of infancy. The stage of infancy is having the crisis of trust and mistrust. If the care they get from the mother is very, very good, consistent, they will develop a trust, and that trust will be spread over to other individuals or other people as well, and failing which, they will develop the mistrust. And satisfaction of this case, the psychological crisis, if met very satisfactorily, they will develop a virtue called hope. So this hope will continuously guide the child in the later life as well. Likewise, in the second stage, which he termed as the toddlerhood, it is up to the age of 4, from 2 years of age, the crisis is autonomy versus shame and doubt. So they want to do certain kind of activity independently. If the parents, with their guidance, help the child to do those activities with constant monitoring, then they will develop the virtue of willingness. Otherwise, they will be always in the constant shameful atmosphere, as well as having certain kind of doubts in later years of their life. Then third stage, according to Erikson, it is also known as preschooler, early childhood. It lasts up to the 8 years of age, from 5 years. And the psychological crisis, he named this as initiative versus guilt. So at this stage, this child is in the formal educational atmosphere. They want to explore new things, new kind of activity, involve new kind of activity. And if the parents and the teachers help the child to do those kind of activities, they will develop a purpose for their life. They will choose a purpose for their life, or otherwise, failing which, they will develop the guilt in their later years of their life. So the fourth stage, according to Erickson is a grade schooler, which is also known as middle childhood, and it lasts up to the transitional teenage period, 9 to 12 years of age. And this particular stage met a very, very important psychosocial crisis. He named this as industry versus inferiority. That is, the child wants to be very industrious. If you encourage the child, he will try to do the activities with utter self-esteem. Otherwise, if you do not encourage the child to do certain kind of activities with their own initiation, then they will develop inferiority complex, and thereby they may also develop some kind of problematic behavior in their in these years, which is very, very formative period of life. And success in this particular stage is develop a virtue, which is known as competence. So it is very important from the part of the teacher as well as from the part of the family as well to encourage and reinforce their children to initiate or begin some activities and to feel industrious, competent, and feel confident in doing all those activities. So we must encourage them. Then the fit from fit, we must talk about from the fit stages onwards, because this is the college stage, and maximum students are getting through different kinds of crisis and conflicts in this stage. So the fifth stage, according to Erickson, is the adolescence or teenager. It starts from the 13 to 19 years of age. So the psychological crisis here is the identity versus role confusion. I think everyone has all the academy from the education, so they will understand about the identity crisis at this period. So in order to show their identity, even they involved in certain kind of antisocial activities, that just to show that they are having some social value, and for that, without judging, they may involve in certain kind of antisocial activities. So at this particular period, it's very important to offer some of the guideline from the home atmosphere as well as from the college or the school environment to develop a very, very strong identity. And for that, the teacher must help the child to unfold their talents, and thereby to help them to identify any one or two talents and to identify their roles with those talents only. So they will definitely develop the fidelity. Otherwise, the infidelity will be developed, and they will lost trust against everyone. So it is the most formative period, and everyone must take care of it. The next stage, sixth stage, is the early adulthood, or known as the young adult. It starts just after the teenage, and it lasts up to 40 years, actually 40 years. And the crisis, or the, you can say, the conflict made by this particular young adult at this stage is intimacy versus isolation. So during this stage, we explore relationship, and this relationship leading to us long-term relationship with commitment with someone other than the family members. We are confined to marriage system. So successful completion of this stage can result in happy relationship and the sense of commitment, safety, and care within that relationship. Otherwise, they will develop all those crises, like isolation will be developed in them. So it's very important that as their adult, young adult, so if they understand about their crisis, they can, if they think about their crisis, they can also find out the solution for themselves. So success in this stage will definitely lead to the virtue of love. Love, the eternal love, not only confined to some, only one or two relationship, but it will be spreading over the all humanity. Then the seventh stage, according to Erickson, is the middle-aged adult, and the stage is up to 60 years of age, and the crisis they meet at this particular stage is generativity versus stagnation. So psychologically, generativity refers to making your mark. So at this stage, you are in the workplace, or you are going to be retired. So maximum social work, maximum things you do at this particular stage. So you also want certain kind of recognition. If you are not being recognized, then something, some internal crisis will happen, and this may lead to certain kind of bigger problem in the later life means after retirement. So the virtue you develop satisfaction of your crisis is the care. Then the last one, it will last up to you till death, and it starts from the actually 60 years, but in some other information, it is started from 65 years of age, later adulthood or old adult. So it is the ego integrity versus despair. This is the most, critical period of our one's life. So during this time, we contemplate to different kinds of, look into the accomplishment of our work. We try to calculate what we have done successfully, what we have not done successfully. We do a little bit calculation. And if this calculation is happier, then we become a very wise person. So these are the stages as advocated by Erickson. As teacher, we must understand the crisis felt by the person in its different stage. So this is one of the very important crisis one feels during the stage of adolescence, the identity crisis. And if they are feeling this kind of identity crisis, then they will be totally confused, and their purpose of life will be also disrupted. So it's very important for a teacher as well as the parents must also understand the identity crisis during the teenage period. These are some of the examples of psychosocial problems. We'll later on look into those. Our main topic here is to maintain the psychosocial well-being. So how to maintain the psychosocial well-being? Dr. Das, what is my time limit? Up to what time I have to speak?
30 minutes, ma'am. 30-35 okay. Minutes.
Okay, so I think I have 10 minutes more.
More, yeah. 10 minutes more.
Okay. So most important crisis or most important psychosocial problem we face during every stage of life is stress and anxiety. So stress is physical or emotional reaction or response to any kind of change, whether it is internal or external. So stress is a form of pain that comes to tell something which one needs to change or learn. So if stress is felt unattended, it can lead to anxiety. And this is the difference between stress and anxiety. Sometimes anxiety may be manifested with a physical symptom. So a little bit of stress is very good for your performance. So this is the mathematical equation of stress. So what do you understand by this? So if you have more coping ability, that is, if you have more strength, you feel stressed. So don't be afraid of the thing that you are stressed. You have the coping ability, inner strength. That is why you have felt stressed. So if you are feeling stressed, it is a good sign. You have the inner strength. That is why when you are pressurized, and if you have the inner strength, you have the coping ability, you will feel the stress. Otherwise, those persons who are not having this inner strength, or those who are not having this coping ability, or not totally bothered about the coping ability, they will just leave it. So they will not feel the stress. So little bit of stress is very, very good for your performance. But when it exceeds, then you must think about it. So these are some of the symptoms of stress. These are the physical symptoms, mental symptoms, and cognitive symptoms. Some important symptoms are like you have the indigestion problem. This is the physical symptom. You have sometimes blurred vision, high BP, headache, nausea, dietary disturbance. Sleep disorder is one of the very, very important symptom of physical stress. Then mental symptoms of stress are like blocking, then forgetfulness, anxiety and stress are always there, mental confusion, rejection to criticism. When you are not able to handle the failure, then we will be mentally stressed. Then memory loss, negative thinking, then poor judgment are the symptoms of cognitive stress. Then emotional stress, low self-esteem, angry, suspicion, jealousy. Then crying tendency. Some people are having the crying tendency and they are actually emotionally stressed. There are certain kinds of behavioral stress also, like sleeping disorder is also one kind of behavioral stress. Then drug dependency. Some people are constantly under the drug or medication, and if medication is over, then they will feel stress. Again, they have to go to the doctor and seek the medication. So these are some of the symptoms of stress, and long-term effects of stress may aggravate hypertension, then heart disease, then some other physical problem, then migraine is a part and parcel of long-term stress, then sometimes suicidal tendency, mental illness, and behavioral issues are also associated with stress. Then these are the stress at workplace, and some stresses are also homeborn. So sudden death of a family member, you cannot just overlook it. So you will be get stressed. So it is bound to have a stressful atmosphere at your workplace or at home atmosphere, but it is better to identify all those. So there are different types of stress, but truly speaking, I feel that there are only two kinds of stress. One is acute, which is short term, and when people are facing stress out of the recent activities, it is the acute stress. There is also way out to get rid of it. And the other is the chronic stress. It is a long-term stress. And when the person finds no hope to avoid stress, then it becomes a chronic stress. So chronic stress may lead to certain kind of traumatic situation as well. Then what to do? So it's my opinion that you must try to find out what are the things under your control and what are the things beyond your control. If you can identify those things, then you may not be stressed at all. So the thing is that we are always rushing towards the things which are not under our control. So external factors are uncontrollable. External factors, the environmental factors, those factors you need to identify, and this is not controllable one. So you should be adapt to those uncontrollable stress or factors. And internal factors are controllable, and you must learn the strategy to how to cope with those stress. So these are some of the internal and external factors. So external factors controllable are like the uncontrollable are like the natural environmental causes, the government policies. So you cannot now give the opinion about the NEP. So it has already been given. It has been trust, and we have to follow it. Then population growth, date of loved one, military deployment, then world economic crisis, which we are going through, then other kind of world situation. Then controllable are like the jealousy, ego, greed, then anger, lust, pride, habit, hatred, attitude, addiction, too much expectation. That is one of the most important trigger, stress trigger. We expect more, and that is why we become stressed, and relationship problem, and many more other controllable, and you must able to know all those. Then these are some of the way out. Suppose if you cannot suppose the stress, you cannot avoid that, you better to accept it. But if there is a chance to avoid, try to avoid those stress. And if you are given maximum option, try to alter the stress. And if there is no way out, try to adapt to certain kind of stressor. It is beneficial for your holistic well-being. So these are some of the quick tips. So hurriedly, actually, I have prepared PPT yesterday only, because I'm going through a very personal crisis. My uncle expired recently, and we are also observing the ritual till now. It will be over on Sunday only. So these are the tips. So I have thought that attending to this seminar, I will be also to some extent stress-free listening to the resource person. So positive belief. Yes, positivity. Positivity is the only thing. So try to make your failure as an opportunity. Be happy and try to make others happy as well. And stay away from gossip, and which is very, very tough, isn't it? So build empathy, respond, don't react. We people try to react first without judging the situation. We react and later on we regret. It is not the thing. So first you pause, give a pause and try to understand what has been communicated. Respond it, don't react. And try to start a new hobby during this pandemic period. And if any relationship makes you unhappy, just give a pause. Think over later on. And later on, if you find it okay, then again continue. Then if you are feeling stress or identify any symptom of stress, which we have discussed, then ask why. And ask, is your why strong enough? And define your why with proper justification, and definitely you will get a workable answer. And if options are coming, give a chance to your options. Give a chance to your choice. Then keep yourself busy with your favorite activity. I know lots of things have been coming up in the explored, and it has been shown in the social media as well, like drawing, painting, people are involved in such kind of activities. So keep yourself busy with your favorite activities, which you have forgot due to the overburden of activity. So switch over to those activity once again. You will get solace out of your work. Then do physical exercise, walking regularly, and build resilience, bounce back to normalcy. So it's very common that we are having problem, but it is also our duty to bounce back to normalcy. So how to build this resilience? So by exercising regularly, you can keep your mind calm and cool and get enough sleep. Respond, as I have told you, respond more, react less. Practice your skill, maintain time. If you do not maintain time, again, you will be stressed to completing your work. Set your goal as per your capacity. And this is the mismatch between the people, that there is a mismatch between the aspiration and the, that is the goal setting behavior and the achievement motivation. And that is why people get depressed and frustrated. So always set your goal as per your capacity and develop strong relationship with significant people in your life. And this is a very significant saying by Viktor E. Frankl. He is a survivor of World War II. He said that, Bandhanam also told about it, like when we are no longer able to change the situation, we are challenged to change ourselves. So it is better to change ourselves, because situation may not change for us. So try to change sometime as well. So it is very common to everybody, everyone knows about it. So maintaining a healthy lifestyle, we can build resilience and we can think about overall well-being. So meditation, start the meditation first. How to start? So there are lots of meditation process. First start with the minimal, like for a smaller time frame. So do the breathing exercise, sit in a very comfortable way, relax your arms and hands, and feel your emotion. When you are expert in meditation, then you can control your emotion. Just like the classical singer can do any kind of harkat. So they can control their vocal notes. Likewise, you will be expert later on. But if while meditating, if things comes to your mind, let it be, think. Then slowly you restrict to one emotion and think about it. Definitely, you will feel very good. So meditation is a very, very workable solution to keep your overall holistic well-being in proper order. So these are some of the benefits of meditation: physical, mental, emotional, spiritual, everything. Like, it brings harmony to your life. It improves your memory power. It improves your focusing it makes you able to focus on your purpose, that it balances emotion, it increases immunity, reduces stress, regulate heart rate. You all know about it, but the thing is that you do not practice. So it's very important, because you have enough time. So try to fit yourself for the new normal. The concept of new normal has been immersed, that everything has been will be started anew. So for that, keep yourself ready for this new normal. So this is the holistic treatment for the spiritual well-being, general well-being, physical well-being, psychological well-being, and social well-being. Already we have talked about it. So personally, I listen to Sister Shivani a lot. And during this pandemic period, if you try to speak to these 10 powerful thoughts to yourself, your inner voice, then it may definitely increase your emotional immunity. So sit in a corner every day and repeat these powerful thoughts, speaking to yourself. Speak to yourself that I'm a very powerful being. So feel this power within you. I am powerful. I'm not having any kind of physical or mental disease. I'm powerful. I'm a peaceful being. I can even preach peacefulness among my surrounding, because I'm peaceful. Then I'm fearless being. I'm nothing to worry about the infection and all, because I'm powerful. So nothing will come into me, and I'm fearless, and my body is perfect and healthy. So nothing to worry about. So I'm very powerful. So I'm perfect and healthy. God's power and blessing is a circle of protection around me. And this circle of protection is not only around me, it is been being my planet. So thereby, is if you try to focus on these kind of things to yourself, definitely you will be emotionally immune, and this emotional immunity will help you to be able to cope up with this pandemic situation. Then these are the 5 C's for coping with stress. Hurriedly, I'm going to tell you. Challenge, if you're feeling any kind of challenge, then fix it, fight it, and finish it. Then cope, if you're getting any kind of stress, cope with, apply general and specific coping strategy. Then control your expectation. You will be definitely very happy. Then communicate, speak out what you feel. Then cooperate, listen to your inner voice. And if you need some expert suggestion, then take the expert suggestion as well. And if nothing is working out, then consult Dr. Ali. Do you know Dr. Ali? He resides nearby. He's a very famous person. He looks like this. He is Dr. Ali. So meet Dr. Ali. If nothing is working out, accept whatever is going around, accept it, then listen to it and introspect. Definitely you will find the solution from your inner strength. So in conclusion, I want to say that there is no lock manufacturer without a key. So our problems are also like this. attached to one problem, there are millions of solutions. And to find out those solutions, stay positive and ensure this biopsychosocial well-being. So recently I did one study, and my daughter was also one of the part of this study. And she told me that, Ma, the situation is not good, but still we have to adapt to the situation because the stars cannot shine without darkness. So we will find out new solution out of this pandemic. So it struck me, and I put this in my conclusion, stars cannot shine without darkness. So amidst negativity, we have to find out the positivity, and this positivity will be amassed as powerful soul within us. So lastly, I want to conclude with a very, very important, like, actually when I'm feeling low, I try to play a little bit of song, and this particular song I want to play here. It is just like the emotional booster to me every time. So I want to share with you. It's a 3-minute song only. Please go through it. Whenever I feel very low, it automatically boosts up my emotion. So thank you so much. I'm not getting anyone here. Hello?
Yeah, ma'am.
Hello, I'm audible?
Yeah, it's
so okay. I'm not seeing anyone here, so I thought, hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
So thank you so much, and I wish everyone a very happy Teacher's Day in advance, and thank you once again for giving me this opportunity to share my views with all of you. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Purabi Vasa, madam. Your very informative presentation. Your presentation is so nice and also helping the all of the participants.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes. Next. As per CDL program, I would like to request Dr. Anindita as professor, Department of Education, to introduce invited speaker. Anindita, please.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon, one and all. I, Dr. Anindita Das, on behalf of the organizing committee, Gosaigaon College, take the opportunity to introduce our next distinguished speaker from Banaras Hindu University, Professor Anjali Bajpayee from the Department of Education, who has the specialization in the area of science, teaching, learning, curriculum, educational technology, and contemporary issues in education. She has been associated with BHU for the last 30 years, first as a student and then as a faculty since 1997. She is a member of various committees of BHU, such as Hill, Research Development Committee, School Board, Residential Allotment Committee, etc., and involved in organizing seminars, refresher courses, etc. Till date, she has guided about a dozen of PhD scholars. She has published more than 3 dozen papers in various national journals, co-authored 2 books, and done a minor project and a major UGC project. She has participated in many national and international seminars and conferences. She has been the coordinator of MED part-time of education faculty till 2016 under BHU. She has presented a proposal of School of Education of Faculty of Education for the Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya National Mission of Teachers Training Scheme of MHRD, and BHU has been granted the School of Education in November 2016. She has also been associated with ICSSR, NCTE, and UGC as a member of various committees. Presently, she is a coordinator of Center of Curriculum, Policy, and Research. So here I would like to invite Professor Anjali Bajpayee, ma'am, to share her valuable thoughts with us on the topic online classes in pandemic situation, psychosocial fallout. Once again, welcome you, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you.
Good evening, Anindita. I'm sure you can hear me.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening.
And thank you for introducing me so elaborately. Actually, the introduction is sometimes it sounds like very nice that you're being introduced like this. And thank you, Dr. Labanya, and thank you to the principal of the Kusai College for giving us this opportunity for sharing our views with so many people. And last but not the least, thank you to Dr. Dinesh Das for being so perseverantly asking us to be here, managing all of it, and of course connecting us to so many people. And it's nice to be here sharing the dais with Professor Vandana and Dr. Purabi. It was wonderful to hear about them. The stage is all set for me just to wind up the things. Professor Vandana very elaborately described about the psychosocial scenario in the educational perspective, how things have changed in 6 months' time since March 23 to this 4th of September. We are in a changed sort of world. We had probably never thought that school will be a place where children would be longing to go. We always felt school was always there. Classes where we used to interact with our students will be something which we will have to see when we can go there or attend there. And students will be not there interacting face to face. I mean, 200 people who are sitting in front of you and 200 people you are connecting virtually, it's so much more different. So suddenly the world has changed. suddenly the times have changed. Suddenly we have to look into a new normal, as Dr. Purabi just said. And of course, all these changes were so fast that to adapt changes which occur slowly, we adapt ourselves to them. But this was so sudden, this virus suddenly came up, and we never expected, because we have always been hearing about such SARS virus. It is not the first time that the world is experiencing the SARS type of virus, but the problem, it will become a pandemic, probably we all had never thought. And the magnitude of the pandemic will be such large, that also we had never visualized. And the time frame, all of us expected that maybe when the summers come, the virus will die off. Now we're expecting maybe when the winters comes, the virus will die off. We were thinking of various types of thing. Maybe the sound will kill the virus. Maybe the heat will kill the virus. Maybe lightning will kill the virus. But the virus is here to stay, as we all know. The only thing is, if like both my previous speakers have said, if things are not as per you want, then you must change according to the thing. So probably the times here for us is to change, to adapt to the new situation, to adapt to the new normal, to adapt to the new sort of educational scenario, which probably we will have in times to come. Now, whenever certain change occurs, this change of shifting from face-to-face to online, these, if we say this is just for 6 months, this is just for 8 months, it's not that. The impact always remains. So probably when we go back to our colleges, when we go back to our schools, things would have changed in some ways. Probably we have so much become used to using technology, we might just think in a different way how to interact with our students, how to interact with our colleagues. There are, like we are saying, we are not the social distancing, but physical distancing has to be there in the social setup. So probably as children used to hug each other, go hand in hand, probably those sort of activities will not be there. Probably we will not be seeing children play ringa ringa roses, holding hands for times to come, maybe another year. So these changes are there. Now, in this scenario, when our classroom has changed to online, what has been the fallout of it? The things which I'm going to talk are already very normal things which we all are discussing in our day-to-day lives, but this I have just arranged it in a more systematic manner. So it is which we don't know, it is nothing that is invented from somewhere else, it is all those things which we are experiencing daily. And also the thing is that these things, again and again, when we hear them out, we feel probably we adjust to them more, because more and more when you're hearing that you have to wear the mask every day when you're hearing, probably that sets in your mind and you become more used to it. So with this backdrop, and we are advancing into the evening, I'll just share my screen with the presentation which I have made. And so as we all were saying that the topic of my discussion or talk was online classes in pandemic situation, a psychosocial fallout. As we have already discussed that. Let us just talk about what is this coronavirus, which has so silently changed all our lives. As I said, this SARS-CoV virus is not new. It occurred earlier as the SARS virus, as the MERS virus, and now this is the novel coronavirus, COVID-19. The difference between this and the earlier SARS or severe acute respiratory syndrome of coronavirus was the carrier was not the humans. Now this time it was the birds, it was the pigs, but this time what has happened, the carrier has become the human being, and therefore the avoidance of touch, therefore avoiding large gathering, has become the new normal time. As we have already discussed, what has been the impact of the whole pandemic, which has resulted in about 1.2 million students or children being out of school in around 200 countries. And slowly we are hearing that Wuhan, from where this virus originated, they have opened their schools for children. So slowly, silently, children are going back to schools. But let's see how they are able to maintain in this new situation where they have to maintain distances, where the children have to sit at not sitting next to their friend. They have to sit at a distance. They have to eat. They have to play in a different sort of situation. Now, media and the government, they are both trying their best to help the people to adapt to this new situation. We are having news, and this somewhere the there is also, like we were saying, there is lot of stress because maybe over information also, because technology has penetrated so much in our life that over information is also creating certain sort of stress. I feel those people who are not aware of much about this virus are probably facing, because the virus is not very very severe. The virus is a simple virus. The only problem is the infection is spreading from human to human, and therefore the care has to be taken. Otherwise, common flu, common cold, we have always been experiences, and many people, as the results are showing, that many people have recovered. They have the antibodies without knowing that they, without experiencing the disease and all. So the thing is, maybe the awareness sometimes creates a lot of information, sometimes also create a lot of stress. So that balance has to be maintained. When children are going to school, when they're going to colleges, when people are interacting, even when the news is there, they share, they disperse their tension, they disperse their information by sharing with us. Now, because they have been isolated in their home spaces, we are saying stay home. And in society like India, where we are always so gregarious, we like large big functions, we like large big gatherings, we like to interact with our fellow people. We are more, as you say, a social animal in many aspects than from other countries. So these things have also changed and also affected our adaptation, our basic well-being. So with this impact, the classrooms which have suddenly changed, they have resulted. What is it? We have shifted from the normal classroom to we have shifted to the virtual classroom. Now, this change to virtual classroom has also been certain positive impact of this also we have seen. See, what has happened, suddenly the technology which we were saying, yes, we must adapt to the blended learning, we must have technology in our classroom, we must have more interactive aspects so that our children can use this, we must have mobile learning, we must have the virtual universities, we must have virtual classrooms, all these things which were being talked as a part of concept suddenly was imposed on us. Now, what that resulted? We quickly not maybe not willingly, but we had to change. We, as we say, that necessity is the mother of all invention. So we quickly had to find some other way to reach out to our children, to our students. So quickly we all tried our best and adapted to a blended learning mode. The universities and the colleges all shifted to a virtual learning mode, and this would definitely help in a form of classroom teaching learning in times to come, which if this COVID situation would not have occurred, we would have taken in our slow pace for maybe 5-10 years. This has suddenly, this virtual, this technological intervention into the classroom, this connectivity has suddenly given us a thought that probably when we go back to our classes, when the things become better, maybe we will adapt to the blended form of teaching learning, where most of the things which can be there on the virtual platform will be shared on the virtual mode. But those things which we feel that face-to-face interaction is a must, because many things we learn face-to-face, the expressions, the feeling of sharing, and many other aspects which we learn face-to-face, that always will be there, because all of us have felt that this online learning is not a solution to the face-to-face learning. It can be complementary, it can be supplementary, but it cannot replace face-to-face learning. So we will, when we go back, probably when we plan for our next sessions to come, we will look for a blended approach where we will see what activities we cannot do in the face-to-face mode, or what activities can be better in the virtual mode, can be done virtually, on what activities which are better in face-to-face mode will be done in face-to-face. And definitely the new technologies, new devices which we are now, new platforms, new like Zoom, like Google Meet, like Microsoft Teams and Upgrad, all these companies are devising their software in such a way that this can help in the teaching learning process. So that certainly has made advancement, the blended form of learning. Then definitely this online mode has given us access to lot many material. The teaching learning material has improved. We have access to ebooks, we have access to e-content, and the content which is being developed, it has got more sort of integration of different sort of medias into it. We are seeing that we are having the text, we are seeing that we are having the animations, and we are seeing that teachers are making effort to make their online presentation also having lot of multimedia content into it. So that just now we saw that Dr. Purubi made us hear a song at the end of a lecture, because that was something different. It was a soothing song which changed the pace of the setting. Probably all of us were there for around 2 hours in this online mode session, and that suddenly changed the whole pace of the session, that brought some livelihood. So teachers are trying to make more enriched online, more enriched virtual, more enriched material, so that the students can have a sort of interactive platform to them. And also definitely more access is there to various types of material. Then another thing which has made us come together, see all 200 of us, somebody sitting at Assam, somebody sitting at Delhi, somebody sitting at Varanasi, all of us are joining here together to interact with each other, to share our views. So a form of new form of collaboration in the teaching community has suddenly emerged. Tomorrow I can request anyone, I can, if I'm taking a class, I can just connect to Dr. Vandana Saxena and ask her input to my students on some aspect of science or inclusive lesson. So that's that aspect. Now the distances have no more been a limitation. People can share their views on different platforms at the same time. That synchronous media, which has suddenly made us more accessible, has made us more collaborative, has made us more open to various forms of resources, is that suddenly there. So as we are saying, large number of academic meetings, conferences have shifted to online, and this will definitely make sharing of ideas more global, more open, and we can have
more interaction.
But this is just it. We have, even the students have had a lot of opportunity in this. The students, the online classes, they can access to different sort of resource person at the same time, the travel, the stay at different places. They can stay at home and do their studies, and they can live at their comfort of their home. See, when they're living in hostels or they're doing coachings at different places, they're living in PGs, they have to manage many at home. The only thing that they have to manage is the online connectivity and of course the computers or the mobile phone. Otherwise, the comfort of home is there. But that also has a challenge, which we will discuss later. It also gives us a time to be more organized. The student can set up their own pace, they can set up their own time frame and do things on their own. And also, this will also help them to, since this online classes which are there, so the students will also be connected to their studies, and all that stress of pandemic will, which is mostly we are talking in the media, we are talking at the home, it will also take their time away from this. And definitely it will give them more opportunity to become technology friendly and learn new techniques, learn new ways of connecting to their teachers, to their, and also access different sort of material which can be there for them. So that will be a benefit for the student, that they will be having a comfort zone of their own, of their home, where they can learn and they can keep pace with their studies. But there are, as we have always been discussing, this online learning has a negative, lot of negative impact. We were saying, we have been hearing, there has been cases of stress, there has been cases of mental distress, there have been cases of loneliness, there have been cases of loss of appetite, as has been mentioned by the previous speaker. So all these things have been there because you are not in that friend zone, as we say. You are not there in the peer group. You are not sharing your things. You are there with the laptop. Even if the peers are there, they're not actually physically present there. So many times when you share your things with your peers, when you're not able to share them directly, it leads to frustration. When the teacher is there in the class, you can directly ask questions. But here you have the bination, you have to wait, you have to type, or you have to wait for your turn to ask the question. And that spontaneous interaction, because it is missing. So there is the barrier in the learning. And also, as I said, only thing you need is an internet connectivity and a device. But this internet connectivity is also an issue. Many times when we are interacting in our meetings, in our seminars, we face the issue of connectivity, which we say, this is where the technology fails us, the inner connectivity problem. So poor connectivity, sometimes the connectivity is not there due to rains, due to weather conditions. So all these things irritates both the teacher and the students. And as a result, there is a sort of distraction which is not there in the face-to-face learning. Also, as we say, prolonged, we had a lot of studies which showed that children were facing, the adults were facing a lot of eye problems. All of us, if we are seeing the screen for more than 2-3 hours a day, then we say that there is itching, there is irritation in your eyes, and then doctors advise different sort of gels. So those things are there. Your posture, you're sitting for a long period, you will have that postural also, problems also. So those are also the issues which are there when you are there. So that is why, as the government took cognizance of this, and NCRT has issued their guidelines in Pragyata that children of 1 to class 8 should have not more than 2 hours of screen time per day. As Dr. Vandana mentioned, this was the scholastic screen times as they have mentioned, and students of 9th and above should have 4 hours to 5 hours of screen time. That is the scholastic. You can have other sort of informal chats, informal interaction which is there, but the scholastic time should not be more than 4 hours for anyone, because then it creates a lot of stress, it creates a lot of problems both in your viewing, in your sight, and that is there. So that has to be taken care. We have, the government has issued the guidelines, and for the preschoolers, it is less than 2 hours there. Now, as we are saying, not only the students, but also the teachers, this mode shifting was not easy. The shifting from offline to online. See, as I'm saying, the technology was there, but we were more comfortable. The comfort zone was there, interacting directly with your students, sharing your classes with them, the chalk, the written board, the written notes were all very much in common. We were using them. So we was not prepared for that. That shift for us also had to be a long time. I would say all of us teachers, not only the students, but also the teachers across level, right from primary to tertiary, have made a lot of effort to adapt to this, especially in the Indian conditions where we did not have the online system so much in place. In the West, people already had, the university already had their online system in place. They had the blended form of learning. They were sharing offline and online content. But here in India, we were not much prepared for that. We had to think in a very different way. We had to move to this new situation. And therefore, it was an unfamiliar zone. Many times we had not been prepared ourselves technologically. The young, new teachers probably were more techno-friendly than the senior ones. So that has to be there. And also how to collaborate the lessons. I'm saying there are various platforms available. There are various technologies available. There are various media content available. But how to join it? How to make it inclusive in our classroom? That had to be kept in mind. That was a huge challenge. And having, even teachers were not all had all that software, not all had all that hardware at their residence to connect to the students. Although that was there, you can connect from home, but for that also you needed certain infrastructure that had to be there. So that aspect was also there. Now parents also were online classes. This was also affecting them. Earlier, when the children went to school or when they went to college, the parents felt that this was their own time. Now they don't have to, at least for some time, the responsibility has shifted to the institution to look after the children. But now they are 24/7 with them. So they have to manage. Many times they have to also assist. earlier only probably for homeworks or probably for some assistance parents were there, but now they were had to monitor the classes which were going on. They had to see what was there. Probably many times the children were not able to connect. Probably many times they had to manage the whether the child is sitting or not sitting and doing the classes. Also, the overuse. Earlier, we all used to say if the children were using the mobile for a longer time, we would say, or they were sitting at the laptop for a long time, we would all say that, leave this, go out. Today, we had to say the otherwise, sit in the front of the laptop, do your classes. So all these things were suddenly new to the parents. The things which they said earlier, don't do, now they had to say, do. They probably had to make changes in their own schedule, their own timings to adjust with the classes of the student. And this was especially there for the specially able children, those who were having some sort of disabilities. So the parent had to assist that child. Earlier, it was the inclusive or the special teacher who was there in the class who used to help the student. But now the parent had to take that role of the teacher and assist. So a lot of change in their lifestyle also resulted, and that also affected their psychosocial balance, and therefore they also had to adapt to this new situation. The home environment had suddenly become different. So all these things were changing. And of course, as we saying, the cost was reducing at some aspect. Maybe the children were not staying at hostel. Maybe the children were not going out. But of course, the data and the other charges were increasing. And we have all heard the stories of certain parents of certain disadvantaged groups, where because they have just one mobile, the children have to only one child could study, only the son could study, or only the daughter could study. And sometimes we have also heard the stories that parents had to sell off many of their important things to purchase a mobile for. So all these things, a smartphone or a laptop for online classes of their children. So these things were suddenly changing. We are having new requirement. We are having new needs, and suddenly a new thought of educational system has emerged. Now, as we say, all this setup, all these setup will go away, all this setup will move away, all this setup will no longer be used in times to come. That is a thought which we have to look into, because we have moved from a very initial step to a few steps ahead. We must integrate this technological intervention in our school system, in our college system, in our higher education system, in some way or the other. We just cannot go back. We cannot forget all these 8 months, 6 months, or maybe another year, because as it is said, as it is experienced, the 19-20 pandemic lasted for around 2 years. So we do not know when the coronavirus goes away. We have to adapt to the new normal. How? Probably when the schools open, when the colleges open, probably we will have to look for a staggered approach in case of timings, in case of days, so that we are able to interact with our students, but both face-to-face, but this online adventure which we have gone into is also there, and also we have able to adapt it in the times to come. So this has to be there. And definitely many times because of not being face to face, we have a lot of the stress problems which we have discussed earlier. So all these things which are there, it affects our students. And because of the social distancing, lack of absence of friends, the lack of normal routines, the teacher students are not able to enjoy teaching as it. Even the teachers, see, we also miss our face-to-face interaction. We are so used to seeing the faces of our students and teaching in that way. We also, teaching was such a fun when we had face-to-face interaction. When you're looking at the screen and teaching, you don't know what is the reaction which is there, because I always feel a teacher gets the feedback from the expressions of his students. So that thing is missing. And also the computer screens are so, you are exposed to a lot of media challenges also. Many times we are saying the students are safe in the space of their home, but that also we can say that they are being exposed to a lot of unsafety on the virtual media, on the technological they are facing. We are seeing this increase in cyber crimes. Students don't know, they view different sort of things which has to be checked and controlled. So what, and again, we are saying it is easier to learn from print than to learn from the text and the screen. The soft, when you're reading, the books give you a different sort of feeling. When you have a textbook, I still enjoy reading stories in a hard book form rather than in a soft form, because that gives you more of a fun. You can fold the page whenever you want, you can put a marker wherever you want. So that having reading a hard book and reading a soft book or a soft material makes a lot of difference. You feel you have covered so many number of pages, you can flip and go back to the pages. Here it is a bit difficult. So those things have to change. So teaching learning process, as we say, is a two-way communication, but this online interaction, which has made, we are trying to make it a two-way communication. This sociological impact changes a lot of time in this. So we have to adapt to a new system of education for us. And that would definitely be a more open world. And as I was saying, that government of India, which has already come out with a new education policy, has suggested for a National Educational Technological Forum, NETF, for making technology more integrated into the classroom. And certainly the steps which have been taken by the government in form of Diksha, in form of Nishtha, for training the teachers, Swayam, EPG Pathshala, for providing the content, and also for counseling the student in the form of Mano Darpan program of NCERT. All these efforts we are taking so that we can make this online learning more enjoyable, more in the reach of the students. Definitely the challenges are many, but we have to move ahead, we have to adapt. We cannot leave all these things which we have learned in these 6 months and probably more than. So we somehow have to adapt to a new normal in the teaching learning process, in our classes, with technology and with face-to-face, interacting with our students, having some sort of new balance between the two. Maybe that will also create more interesting. We have to use media in a more interesting way. We have to move it more judiciously so that the teaching learning process remains two-way communication with the use of online media. Thank you, Dr. Das. I think I have kept my time.
Yes. Very good. You have to maintain your time, ma'am.
Thank you, Professor Anjali Bajpai, ma'am. You had delivered an informative presentation about the psychosocial components. Once again, I thank you, Bajpai, ma'am. And next, on the eve of our 59th Teachers Day, I, as a convener of this conference, wish all learned ma'am to happy Teachers Day.
Same next, to you.
Yeah, thanks. Next, I go to the next agenda. It is as per our CDL program, there is a
question answer session, but we have not received any relevant question from the participant side. So we have suspended the serial program on question answer discussion. Next, I go to the next agenda, vote of thanks. I would like to request Mrs. M. Pathak to deliver vote of thanks. Mrs. M. Pathak, please.
Honorable Principal Sir, Vice Principal Sir, respected dignitaries, my dear colleagues, and all the participants, it's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of Gosagao College, the team, and even special guests present in today's webinar, let me call it fraternity of this amazing and knowledge-loaded national webinar here together. And on my own behalf, extend a very hearty vote of thanks to all speakers for gracing our important work and sharing us your findings and opinions today. A big thank you to Professor Vandana Saxena from University of Delhi, Dr. Purabi Vaishya from Guwahati University, and Professor Anjali Bajpayee from Banaras Hindu University, who took out time from their busy schedules to join us today. And we are also grateful, very grateful for their efforts towards enlightening our thoughts on his vast and important topics, which has imparted a major proportion of our society. This COVID-19 pandemic, its impact on psychosocial challenges on online education for teachers and students. I may like to express our sincere thanks to our principal sirs, vice principal sir, Mohammad Samsuddin Sardar, for giving us this amazing opportunity and guiding us, as well as providing encouragement to us throughout it, conducting a webinar effectively and sincerely. Thank you so much, sir. I also wish to express my gratitude to Mrs. Lavanya Lagar, HOD, Department of Education, Mohammad Abul Hassan Ansari, and Dr. Ananita Das for working together throughout. Thank you, all of you. I am also very grateful to Dr. Dinesh Das, HOD, Department of Economics, and Coordinator of IQAC, for collaborating and conducting this webinar successfully. Thank you so much, Dr. Dinesh Das. Further, we are grateful to Mr. Medini Thalekdar for handling all the technical works and making it easy to perform and conduct the entire webinar without any glitch. Thank you for this immense support and work. And we also would like to acknowledge our gratitude to all the participants who took active part and worked equally in commencing this webinar successfully. Thank you very much.
Thank you all. Happy Teachers' Day to everyone.
Happy Teachers' Day, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Nice meeting you. Thank you so much.
Bye, Anjali.
Bye.
One moment, I want to share with all of you. 1 minute, yes. Please. Dr. Anindita Das is my direct student, and I'm very happy to get her today. And she's my direct student, and I'm very, very, what to say, I'm so happy that my direct student is conducting or organizing this seminar. She's so capable. I'm very happy to see her. So,
I mean, it's a very good thing.
Students
for
have, that's why, yeah. Yes, yes. We are teachers because of our students. So on the eve of this Teachers' Day, I once again wish my students a very happy Teachers' Day, wow, along with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Thank you. Yes. Thank you. Please bye.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Once again, I thank the principal of Gusaigaon College, the our learned research person, coordinator, Dr. Dinesh Das, computer operator, and the, all the participants and all my colleagues of Gusaigaon College. Thank again, one again, and on the eve of 59 Teachers Day, I wish happy Teachers Day. Thank. And today, this is the end of the conference. Okay, now.
Anindita, bhal lagil de, tumak dekha pae, moi gome puanasilo, huni silo, pahore gulo. Yeah, bye-bye.